Okay, I guess we're set. So, welcome. I'm Gerald Jorn. As Rob explained, I won't actually have to introduce myself. I'm not used to that being introduced. So, start. So, basically, yesterday you've been working with matrices, and depending on how far you got, more matrices and matrices and matrices. So, often at this point, people are kind of sick of working with matrices. So now we're actually going to start working towards the program. After you finish step two, you have the matrices. So you basically have a blueprint of everything you will need to target inside people's head, pretty much. And then we'll work towards the program. But the program is only step four. So today I'll speak about step three, which is what you do in between. Basically, it's kind of like if you want to try to change something, you'll have to understand it first. And part of the understanding comes from studying what you want to change, but part of the understanding comes from knowing what you have to do to change those things. And it's the latter bit we'll be discussing today. When people didn't yet follow the Intervention Mapping Summer Course, their naive idea about behavior change or changing health or other things kind of looks like this. They think you make an intervention and then you improve people's health. And as you know by now, unfortunately, that's not how it works. There's something in between, which is a human, or if you work with intervention mapping and you want to change their behavior, more specifically, their brain. So basically, today we'll be talking about how to change things in people's brains. I use this example, which is unfortunately in Dutch, but it looks so flashy that I reuse it anyway. This is a list about substances. At the x-axis, you see different substances. And on the y-axis, you see how damaging they are for the user themselves. That's in green, ironically. And to others, which is in red. And as you see, alcohol, heroin, crack cocaine are by far the most damaging drugs we have in society nowadays. And other things like ecstasy or mushrooms are much less damaging. But the drug that is used by far the most in the world, which some of you are using actually right now, coffee, is not actually in this list. And that's because coffee is actually good for your health. But there's one little catch. Coffee is healthy, so it's actually nice to drink a lot of coffee. But there's one substance in coffee called cafestol, which is in the, I don't know how you properly pronounce it in English, but it has a weird word, cafestol. And it's in the skin of coffee beans, thank you. And it hires your cholesterol. So that's actually the only unhealthy thing in coffee and the only reason why you should limit your caffeine intake. But it depends on whether you drink filtered coffee or not. So if you drink espresso or Nespresso, which is this technology with these little cups you see on the left, then you should actually limit your caffeine intake because otherwise you ingest too much cafestol. But if you drink filtered coffee through paper, then it's okay and you can drink as much as you want. Who here sometimes drinks espresso or Nespresso? So coffee that's not filtered through paper. Okay, so pretty much almost everybody. Okay, so now that I've told you that this coffee is actually bad for your health if you drink too much and you should limit it, who will now switch to only filtered coffee for the rest of your life? Nobody. Okay, what this nice little example does is show you why giving people information about health effects won't really change their behavior, as you see here. I told you that you're doing something that's actually bad for your health, and nobody changes. That's incredible. And actually, a lot of people who develop interventions will be stunned by this. Actually, they're stunned for like 2 seconds, and then they usually move on with life as usual. But the point is, giving people knowledge, telling people that stuff is bad for them, doesn't change their behavior. So we'll need to know what exactly does change their behavior. So we need to know more about what's in their minds. And that's kind of what you've been working on so far. So people can have specific thoughts, like, for example, whether people like the effects of a high dose of MDMA, that's the active substance in ecstasy pills, or whether they prefer a lower dose, what their friends think they should do, whether they can actually obtain pills with a lower dose. These are different kinds of beliefs or subdeterminants that you've been working with yesterday, although it would be very much of a coincidence if any of you happen to work with ecstasy use. And as you know, these are part of determinants. They are like subdeterminants of larger determinants, more generic variables, which we will now use to work towards change. Because if you apply some method for behavior change to try to change people's behavior, it's kind of the same picture you get when you think about interventions working directly on health. There's actually a lot of stuff in between. Methods for behavior change don't directly change behavior. There exist no tricks that you can use to change people's behavior. All behavior change goes through people's minds. So if you have a method of behavior change, there's a theoretical principle you can apply. You first have to apply it in the real world, in an application, which then changes subdeterminants, for example, beliefs, if you use the reasoned action approach, which are a part of the determinants, and the determinants influence performance objectives. And if you achieve all your performance objectives, people change their behavior. So this is like the causal chain that you'll have to work with. And this is what we'll be working with in step three. So step three has three tasks. Actually, it had lots of tasks, but they combined some tasks. So now we have three tasks. And we'll actually start with the bottom one, and then we'll work up against towards the top one, because it's more useful usually to speak about themes, components, scope, and sequence when we already discussed what the methods and applications are. And I usually start this lecture, and so I will do that now as well, with a redux of step two, because usually at this point, lots of groups have been working with step two. Not everybody will have managed to finish it, and it's useful to all be on the same page before we actually go into using the results of step two. So if this is all, if the next 20 minutes are very boring, that's a good sign. That means you're completely on track. So the model of human behavior that we generally work with is that we want everybody to be happy. So we want to increase everybody's quality of life. And we know health is an important predictor of quality of life most of the time. And we know that behavior predicts both health and quality of life. And health is quite hard to influence directly, but behavior, well, is also quite hard to influence directly, but we have some ideas about how to do that. Behavior is predicted or created the consequence of two things: people's personal determinants, so what they think, and things in their environment. And personal determinants are usually defined as literally everything that is within a person. And the environment is literally defined as everything that's outside a person. So together, these two are by definition, literally by definition, an exhaustive description of reality. So you have reality and you have a person, and some parts of reality influence some aspects of that person's behavior. So you have environment and individual themselves. And the environment, we distinguish several layers. You have the individual themselves, when you speak about their personal determinants. And then in the close proximity, you have their interpersonal environment. So right now, we are each other's interpersonal environment. One level higher, you have an organization. You have a community that's even larger. For example, the famous closely knit Maastricht community. You have society as a whole, and in theory, you even have supranational, if you speak about different countries, continents, EU, etc. And these different levels enable you to use different methods to try to influence people. So this is the basic. Now, if we look closer to what you want to do, if you want to change the environment, actually, you get a repetition, because everything inside the environment of our world nowadays, pretty much everything, is the consequence of behavior of other people. So that means that if you want to change somebody's environment, you have to figure out which environmental actors control those aspects of their environment. And those environmental actors are persons or groups of people. And therefore, by definition, all their behavior is a consequence of two things: personal determinants and environment. So they also have an environment. So if you want to change their environment, you have to figure out which environmental actors can behave in a way to control their environment. So basically, this goes on and on. So that means that what works for the target population individual will also work usually for people at higher levels in the environment. So if you understand how to work with the target population individual, you understand also how to change their environment. As you probably discussed yesterday ad nauseum, behavior, when we talk about behavior, we don't actually talk about behavior. When we talk about behavior, we actually usually use behavior as an umbrella term to discuss a lot of different related behaviors. For example, when you discuss condom use, you usually don't actually mean the actual use of the condom, the only thing they practice in high school in the Netherlands with a banana. You mean that people have to decide to use condoms, they have to buy condoms, they have to discuss condom use with their partner just at the right moment, not too late, and they actually have to apply the condom properly. So there are a lot of different sub-behaviors, which we call performance objectives, that together form the target behavior. And when deciding whether something is a performance objective, you look at the determinants and the environment. So if you have a behavior, you can cut it up into little slices in like 1,000 slices. Like if you talk about negotiating condom use, for example. In theory, you could make an entire decision tree, creating entire dialogues and making every decision a little behavior, but that would be going way too far. The point is, when you think about performance objectives, is that you think about which sub-behaviors have different determinants or different environmental factors. So the performance objectives are kind of like an organizing principle to help you think about everything that's important for your final umbrella behavior. So you have all your performance objectives, and then for every performance objective, you have the environmental factors and the determinants, which by definition will be different for every performance objective, because that's how you chose your performance objectives. So it basically boils down to the personal determinants, because if you want to change somebody's environment, you also do that through personal determinants, just not their personal determinants, but the personal determinants of somebody in their environment. And personal determinants are inside people's brain. And they are inside people's brain because all our behavior is controlled from our motor cortex, which is roughly located here, and it's pink. And the motor cortex is controlled from other regions of the brain, by definition. Because we know that the motor cortex, there are neurons, there are nerve cells, and they get activated by other neurons elsewhere in the brain. So by definition, if you want to change a human's behavior, the only way you have to change the human's behavior is to make sure that you change something in their brain, which makes sure that the motor neurons fire at the right time, blah, blah, blah. Unfortunately, the kind of variables that we are used to working with, like attitude, aren't located somewhere in the brain, like a green little area. So that's a bit of a problem. But psychology, over the past 100 years, found a solution to this. And the solution is based, actually, inside the brain, or one perspective on the solution is based inside the brain, because inside the brain, we have, and they look like this, and they don't actually matter. They're just to explain the way of thinking. These neurons, they are like cells with like a body, like a little clump, and they can activate or deactivate other neurons. So your entire brain, everything you're thinking and feeling right now, actually consists of these neurons and their activation patterns. This concept of activation spreading through these neurons also works at higher levels when you think about human psychology. And for this, I have an interactive exercise because somebody once told me that it helps to keep your audience awake, especially in the morning. So now, pay attention to the screen because I will show 15, 20 words for 1 or 2 seconds each. And the only thing you have to do is not write them down, but remember them. And then afterwards, I'll show you a list of words and you'll have to indicate for each word whether it was in the first list or not. Does that seem doable on this Wednesday morning? Okay, go. Apparently, I have to do the clicking now. Okay, so was the word cloud in the list? Excellent. Hospital?
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
No. Yes. No.
Ha ha! So, doctor was not in the list. How does this work? I hear you wonder. This works because of the neurons. So if at any point in the next 2 days you are a bit confused and you don't know how to explain something, you just say, because of the neurons. It works because basically all the words in the list were very closely related to the target word, doctor. So hospital, stethoscope, dentist, treatment, lawyer, sick, they were all closely related to the doctor concept. And when I named those lists in your brain, the doctor concept received a little bit more activation all the time. And when I ask you whether a word was in the list, you don't have a video in your brain that you can turn back. So the mechanism your brain actually uses to figure out whether something was in the list or not is to kind of probe the activation of the concept. And the doctor concept received so much activation through related concepts that your brain thinks, well, obviously it was in the list, otherwise it wouldn't be activated right now. So that's kind of how it works. And it also works for memory. So if many years from now, you're teaching your own intervention mapping summer course, and you think about studying, and then you think about the nice intervention mapping summer course here, and Maastricht, and the Maas, and summer, and Luna Rossa, and ice cream, for example. That's also a path of associations. That's similar to what you get with the words or at a neuronal level. So that gives us actually a way to think about the brain in a useful way. So we have perception, that's stuff that comes in. We have behavior, that's stuff that comes out. And we have something that's in between. And all we know about the stuff that's in between is that it's like loads, like billions, 87 billion, I think, neurons, which is a bit much to map. So we'll have to think of some other way to think about it, but that we can use this spreading activation concept to think about the brain anyway. For example, we can say we have some concepts that are closely related. For example, how our friends think about condom use, that's actually kind of similar. It's all about approval or disapproval of friends. It's all about different people. So those are kind of related. And we have something else that we could call the attitude about condom use, because they're also related concepts. So we have Piet, Eva, and Bas, which are typical Dutch words. Their opinions together we can define as friends' thoughts about condom use. And whether people think that if they use condoms, the risk of HIV is decreased. But they also might experience less during intercourse. Those two together might be a part of it. So this is kind of what theories do. Theories in psychology kind of make clear definitions of which aspects of human psychology belong together. And they clump them together in a construct, in a determinant, when you talk about behavior change. And they give them a name. So they say subjective norm is everything in your mind that's basically about approval or disapproval of others and what you think other people do. And attitude is about what you think the consequences of the behavior will be and whether you find those consequences desirable or undesirable. Self-efficacy is about whether you think you can actually execute the behavior and whether you can best any obstacles that are thrown your way. And then intention is defined as something that's all of those, plus potentially more, the famous fourth variable in the reasoned action approach, if anybody heard of that. And basically the theory says those actually predict behavior. So behavior, if it is a reasoned behavior that is the consequence of people's intention, which is predicted by those other three variables. And the theory basically does nothing more but put down boxes and arrows, and then you have the model, which is the theory of planned behavior or the reasoned action approach. So back to the model of behavior change. We want to improve people's quality of life, and we work through health a lot of the time. We do this by targeting their behavior. Behavior is caused and health by environmental factors, and the environmental factors are caused by the behavior of the agent. Behavior actually consists of multiple performance objectives, and performance objectives are predicted by people's determinants, which is basically just a way to name different things, related concepts inside people's mind. Those determinants consist of beliefs of lower level variables, and those beliefs are the things we want to change. Because the determinants by psychologists are defined at a very generic level. So we say, for example, subjective norm is approval or disapproval and perception of other people's behavior about a behavior. But that's not something you can target in an intervention. In an intervention, your message will always need to be very specific. It needs to be about something sufficiently tangible to communicate to your target population. So that means that if you talk to people, you'll have to talk to them at the level of beliefs, not the level of the determinants. So the beliefs are actually what you target in your intervention. Literally, actually, since you've made the matrices anyway, the change objectives, which are reformulated beliefs, are what you target in your intervention. So for example, the idea is, in theory, that if somebody thinks that bringing up condom use is very hard, if you change that to the idea that bringing up condom use is quite easy, then you're happy. You achieve this little bit of behavior change, and the likelihood that this person will start condom use negotiations is higher. So the idea is kind of that the determinants consist of beliefs. So if you have one belief that's very low, and you have another belief that's very high, and the other beliefs are kind of in between, the theoretical idea is that the degrees to which these beliefs are held kind of average in the determinant. So if you identify all the important advantages and disadvantages of behavior, which together form attitude, and you manage to change them all in the right direction, either of course then you can decide to actually eliminate one or more determinants because they turn out to not be important, or you think it won't be feasible to actually influence them given the resources you have at your disposal. This is the so-called cyber plot, which is a plot Rick and me, Rick will be speaking later today, kind of combined from different other plots to make it easier for people to select determinants. It might not look like it, but this actually is made to make it easier for you. So the idea is that you have all the different determinants at the left, and then in the left plot you see where people actually score. So you see the degree to which people hold this belief. The second belief here reads, for my health, using a high dose of ecstasy is much worse versus much better. And as you see by the gray dots and by the purple diamond, most people score at the left side. So that means you're pretty sure when you see this that most people actually think already that using a high dose of ecstasy is bad for your health, which already tells you that this is not very useful to intervene on because most people already believe that it's bad for your health. And in the right-hand plot, you see the associations with intention and attitude. So the determinants that are one level higher. So those are the bits of information you use when you select determinants. You look at, do people already believe this in the population? Does everybody score low or high or in the middle? And is this determinant or subdeterminant belief associated to intention, behavior, attitude? Those are the two things you need to evaluate together. Then you've actually made your selection. You have your matrix of change objectives. And then we can move on toward actually trying to change these things. So this is the model we built so far. And now we move on. We move on to the left because we want to change people's beliefs. And we change those beliefs through methods of behavior change. And those methods of behavior change are kind of like prescriptions of things you can do to people to change those beliefs in their minds. Methods of behavior change is a bit of a misnomer because they don't actually change anybody's behavior. They change what's in their mind. And then eventually, behavior is a consequence for this. I don't know who invented the term, but at least it's better than behavior change techniques. So if you apply these methods for behavior change, it's very important to do this properly. They have certain parameters, certain conditions you have to meet, or otherwise they simply won't work. And the reason for this is neurons. No, the reason for this is evolution. And I'll explain now with a short movie how this works. But it's really a lot of work to make a movie in PowerPoint because PowerPoint is definitely not made for them. So pay attention because it's really, really short. So he's dead. And this is sad for Barry. But it's actually, it illustrates something that's very nice about evolution in humans and other organisms. Namely that Fred, well, okay, maybe not Fred, but cavemen with a modicum of intelligence would realize that they actually wouldn't have to move into the bush to find out that that's not a bad idea. They can learn indirectly through observation. And that's called vicarious learning. Animals can do it as well. And it's extremely powerful because it means, of course, you can learn much, much more rapidly than if you have to figure out everything in the world through trial and error. But, of course, also, it doesn't always work. So when one animal observes another animal doing something and getting nice food, then the animal will think, okay, I'll do that too and I'll also get nice food. But if a saber-toothed tiger sees a bird flying off and getting nice food, the saber-toothed tiger won't jump off the same cliff because he realizes what goes for the bird doesn't necessarily go for me. And this is also true, of course, for cavemen and humans. So if a caveman observes another caveman doing, or cavewoman, doing something and then achieving some kind of award for this, they won't necessarily think that doing the same will be true for them. That depends on whether they actually think that their situation is sufficiently similar to the other cavewoman slash man's situation. So if the other cavewoman slash man has a much higher social status, for example, they'll realize that whatever achieves or whatever behavior causes them to get an award might not necessarily cause themselves to get an award. So it's important that you meet some conditions. Modeling is a method that's based on this vicarious learning, this ability to learn indirectly. And it basically consists of exposing people to a model that performs the desired behavior. And then people can learn. But this often doesn't work, because it only works if you actually manage to exploit the underlying evolutionary learning processes. And for this, you have to meet the parameters. So psychologists have basically identified how humans can learn. And these ways of learning, a friend of mine, Rick, and me, believe there are 6 basic evolutionary learning processes. Actually, so other people invented them, but we think those are the basics for all these methods. And these methods for behavior change have been evolved or discovered, researched over the past 100 years or so. And they're basically reconfigurations of these evolutionary learning processes. So humans can learn, but that learning never developed, never evolved, never came into existence to be influenced by prevention developers, prevention workers. So if you want to use humans' ability to learn, in other words, if you want to change any part of their brain, you'll have to make sure that you very carefully mimic whatever situation, whichever learning process you're trying to use, was developed for. And the conditions for that you have to meet are captured in these parameters for use that have been formulated for each of these methods for behavior change. So for conditioning, for modeling, for example, people, the target population has to have the skills to actually repeat the behavior. Gerio always gives the example that I now also always give, because he might have already given it actually earlier, that if he goes to the garage with his car, he sees the mechanic fix his car and he sees exactly what he does, but he still can't repeat it, even though the mechanic receives a reward because he gets paid for it. But because Gerio doesn't have the skills, maybe by now he does, but when he started with his anecdote, he didn't. He can't actually repeat the model behavior. Also, as I said earlier, people have to identify with the model. So if you use a celebrity, it's very unlikely that your target population will think, yeah, of course, if I do whatever this movie star does, it will work out the same for me in my life. So usually when you use a model, it's very important to choose a model that you know your target population will identify with. The model also has to be reinforced. Basically, it has to be rewarded for performing the desired behavior, which also makes sense, because why would somebody repeat a behavior if there's no reason to assume there's anything in it for them? People are like that. And it has to be a coping model instead of a mastery model. A mastery model is a model that just performs the behavior without any problems, so they can already do it. So if you have, for example, Aishi told me this example because it came around earlier. If you have a pregnant woman explaining how she quit smoking because she became pregnant and it was very easy and now she's very happy, then you do have the reinforcement and hopefully people can identify with the model. But every smoking woman who will get pregnant will recognize that this is completely unrealistic, because most smokers have already tried a few times to quit, so they know it's hard, they know you run into problems, you have to struggle. So the model has to reflect this. So a model has to be a coping model. If you meet all of these conditions, it's quite likely that your intervention will work. If you don't, it's quite likely that it won't work. At least this little bit of the intervention. Now, these methods, these kind of like reconfigurations of basic learning principles that humans have been studied over the years, and they've, like determinants, been studied on a very generic level, because psychologists don't care about your target population or your target behavior. They just care about people. So psychologists always study people in general. That's true for determinants, so that's why all these theories are very, very generic, and it's also true for methods. So we have different methods for influencing knowledge, methods for influencing attitude, methods for influencing self-efficacy, etc. So this is why in your matrix of change objectives, even though what you will be targeting in your intervention is the change objectives, those are the messages that will be in the intervention, you still have to organize them by determinant, because that will tell you which methods you can use to change those change objectives. You can already see this different organization in the types of change objectives or beliefs you have in the determinants. So I'll use these 3 examples from the theory of planned behavior or the reasoned action approach, because they're the most well known. Attitude beliefs are always about the probability that a behavior has a consequence and how desirable people think the consequence is. So all the change objectives will also reflect this. All the change objectives in attitude should be about consequences of behavior and desirability of those consequences. Subjective norm beliefs are always about what I think somebody else does, or what I think somebody else approves or disapproves of me doing. and whether I want to conform to that person. It's important to realize that this is not actually about what other people think or do. It's about what I think other people think or do, which is not always the same. And finally, self-efficacy beliefs are always about obstacles and about the degree to which I think I have certain skills to perform the behavior or to deal with those obstacles. So each of these subdeterminants that fall within a given determinant, each of those change objectives with a determinant, always have some consistency, some kind of similar structure, which also helps you to define or identify, sorry, within which determinant some idea, some belief should fall. If you use those methods for behavior change, it's important to choose methods that can actually target the right determinants, as I said before, because different determinants correspond to different aspects of human psychology, sometimes different types of memory, which means that you need to use different types of learning, and the methods work through exploiting these types of learning, and therefore some methods work better for some determinants than for others. So if you have a hammer and your determinant is a nail, and believe me, if you only have a hammer, they will all look like nails. If you have a hammer and your determinant is a nail, then that should work fine. But if your determinant happens to look like this or like this, it becomes harder and harder. And if your determinant looks like this, then good luck to you. So it's important that you have a match between your method and the determinant. Some methods can change some determinants. Some methods can change more determinants. Some can change only one determinant. But it's very important to be aware of this. You also have to use it properly. So for those of you who don't do-it-yourself stuff often, this is how you use a hammer. This or this is not how you use a hammer. And those, if you would use a hammer like that, it can even be dangerous. It can even backfire. So if you don't apply the parameters for use properly, your method might even have the opposite effect that you intended. And finally, this is where the metaphor kind of loses its power, sadly. The determinants that you target also have to be important for your performance objectives and your behavior. So even if you use the right method and you use it properly on the determinant that that method can change, if the determinant is actually irrelevant for the behavior, nothing will change. So for example, if you want to make a cupboard from pieces of wood, then using a hammer obviously is the tool for the job. But if you want to make pieces of wood from a tree, then there are other things that work much better. You might be able to get it done with a hammer eventually, but since we are all working with public money, we might as well use a chainsaw. I can be quoted on that. So, there are some conditions for effectiveness for any behavior change to work. First, the target of the behavior change effort, of the method or the intervention, has to actually predict the behavior. That's why step two is so crucial. If you start focusing on stuff that seems very intuitive and very sensible, but actually in your target population doesn't predict the behavior, then basically what seemed sensible from behind your desk was apparently not realistic. You have to select methods that can influence the determinants. So that's why it's so important to organize your change objectives by determinant in the matrix of change objectives. And then you have to, you're not even done yet, then you even have to apply the method properly. So for example, if you want to target knowledge, and this would be your method, your intervention, and this would be the model. And the thickness of these lines indicates how relevant each determinant is. So in this case, knowledge is kind of important. So you use your tool, and you achieve some effect size if you target behavior. The D stands for an effect size, basically higher is better. But if this is the situation, if this behavior is actually mostly caused, mostly determined by self-efficacy and subjective norm, and knowledge barely plays a role, then you can use the exact same tool to influence knowledge, and it might actually change knowledge, but your effect size on behavior will be negligible, or however you pronounce that. For modeling, we just saw the parameters for effectiveness. The receiver has to have the necessary skills, they have to identify with the model, they have to be a coping model, not a mastery model, and they have to be positively enforced for the desired behavior. So, if this is your modeling intervention, you can clearly see in the blue text that this is a coping model, clearly struggling with the behavior, but finally managing with the help from their friends. So you use your tool, and you achieve an effect size of 0.5, and you're happy. If this would be the intervention you use, you basically use the same method. It also looks like modeling if you look on the surface, but your effect size is much, much lower because you're not applying the parameters for use. And that means you're not engaging the underlying learning processes. And another example, if you have fear appeals, that's a method you can use to change people's risk perception under certain conditions. Namely, if you want to use fear appeals to increase people's feeling of threat, then you have to increase their perceived severity of the negative consequences of a behavior, but also their susceptibility. So they have to believe that those consequences can actually happen to them. And if you manage to achieve those two, you also have to make sure that their efficacy is high enough. So people have to have high response efficacy. They have to believe that they can do something that will decrease the threat. And they have to have high self-efficacy. They have to believe that whatever it is they can do to alleviate the threat is something that they can actually do. If they don't have a high efficacy, then you can't increase their threat. Then they will have defensive responses. So this is an important parameter for use. If you want to use any kind of threatening communication, either your population has to be high in self-efficacy, response efficacy, or you have to achieve increased self-efficacy, response efficacy in your intervention, which is quite hard. So usually you should just never use any fear appeals. Was that a question? Yes, this applies to humans. But it's possible, of course, for different subpopulations. Some subpopulations might actually have high self-efficacy. And children might in some, I mean, children are not really my expertise, but it's possible that they might be more unrealistically optimistic and therefore might be higher in self-efficacy, but I don't know. Basically, if you ever consider doing any threatening communication intervention, then first make sure that none of the other ways you have to increase risk perception would be feasible. Because threatening communication is tricky because it might actually, it's one of the methods that might backfire. It might have the opposite effect. So it should be kind of like a last resort. And since there are like 100 methods, you usually won't get around to fear appeals. So imagine you have a population that's high in efficacy, and this would be your intervention. So you target the severity and you target the susceptibility. Then you use these two tools and you achieve a certain effect size. If you have a population that's low in efficacy, and you use these through these two methods in your intervention, but you also add a third method to target efficacy, then you might achieve the same effect size. But if the third method is not there, then you will achieve a low effect size, which doesn't say anything about the methods you used. It's just because you didn't apply it properly. So it's very important to be aware of these parameters for effectiveness, because you're not using some tricks. You're not pushing some buttons that were made for you when you try to change people. People can learn, which is nice, it's great, but they can't learn for the sake of prevention workers. They can't learn so that they can be helped with doing the right behavior, or manipulated if you're a bit more cynical. So if you want to help them, you have to be very careful that you actually mimic the situations in which they can learn. So you have to meet these three conditions. So these methods for behavior change are specified in psychological theory on the same level as the determinants. Very generic, very abstract, because they come from psychological research, and psychological research is about studying people, not about studying your target population and your behavior with your beliefs, etc. So you always have to translate them to something practical. As you saw before with modeling, basically the description of modeling is just that a model shows something. You can do this in a movie, or you can do it in a serious game, or you can even do it on a poster, or you can use role-playing, or whatever. There are lots of different ways in practice that an intervention using modeling can look like. So there's a clear distinction between what makes it work, the method for behavior change, the theoretical principles, and how it actually looks when you look at it in your intervention, which is the practical application. But of course, before you can use any theoretical principles, you'll have to translate them to the practical application. And in this translation, these parameters are very important to keep in mind. And this is where it sometimes gets tricky, because often as an intervention developer, you think about all these things, you create your matrix of change objectives, you know which methods and applications you want to use, and then you go to an advertising agency, and they have creatives, and the creatives have lots of ideas of their own, because they want to make something that's creative. And it has to be cool, and it has to be appealing to the target population, which is of course nice, and it's useful if it's appealing to the target population. It's probably even a condition for them to even engage with it. But during that process, since they don't usually necessarily professionally have a lot of respect for like boxes and arrows and psychological theory, a lot of these parameters for use get lost in translation if you don't stay on top of it. So you have to be very clear on these parameters for use and keep looking at the product to make sure that they're still satisfied. In this translation, you also have to take into account your population, culture, basically everything that's specific to your specific intervention. So if you have a modeling intervention and you take all these things into account, then depending on the resources you have and the population you want to target and the culture and the context, etc., you could end up with like a protocol for role playing in the classroom or commercial on TV or billboards or any of a thousand other things. So it's important that if you look at an intervention, the way it looks doesn't necessarily tell you much about the methods that are contained in it. And then finally, we get to the step three, where you talk about the themes, the scope, and the sequence, because this is the only thing we haven't like discussed. So you have your matrix of change objectives. In this matrix of change objectives, you organize your change objectives by determinant. And you have to organize them by determinant, because you need to know which determinant they belong to be able to select the method. So then you go, for example, to the intervention mapping book, and you have all the tables with the methods. So you select one or two or three that you think might be feasible. And then you start thinking about how you can actually translate these to practical applications. Note that I kind of speak about it as if this is like a linear activity, but it isn't. It's iterative. So you kind of go forth and back all the time. So it might actually be that you change the method that you want to use, because the one you wanted to use doesn't fit well with the rest, or might not work with your population, or whatever. In this translation, I might have mentioned this in passing one or two times. The parameters are crucial, so it's very important to pay attention to those. And then you have a set of applications, and each of those applications embodies one or several methods, which target one or several change objectives, which are part of the determinants, which predict your performance objectives, which together form your target behavior, which will then increase health or well-being from your population. So then you can move to step four. When you have these applications, you can combine them in lots of different ways. So, for example, you can combine everything into one huge component of your intervention, or you can have different components. For example, you can have in classrooms, you can have two or three or four classes or lessons or whatever, or you can combine it all in one big lesson. And there are, of course, different reasons to do one or the other. So if you have several components, people might drop out in between. If you have one big component, people might not pay attention anymore halfway through, or there are loads of different considerations here. You have to think about the order of the components. It might, for example, be important that you do certain things before you do others. For example, with modeling, it's important that people have the necessary skills. So if you need to increase their skills as well, you might want to start with that and then keep the modeling until later. And you have to be clear if there is some degree of interaction, what should bound those interactions? So which topic should be discussed? If you have classroom discussions again, for example, or if you have peer education and there are discussions, what should be the focal topics? And finally, how everything is tied together into one coherent program that kind of has a brand and that makes sense to your target population. So the first parts are the components. So the way you combine your applications in your intervention creates the components. Then you have to think about the order of these components, which is the sequence, and the order of the applications within each component. Then you have to think about what is actually part of your intervention and what will not be part of the intervention, that's the scope. And finally, you have to have one or several themes to tie everything together into a coherent whole. So that's basically step three. I realized that my little timekeeping device didn't work, so I hope it was roughly an hour. One important thing to remember when you're done is to check the change objectives when you're done with all this. Because each of them is so small, relatively, it's easy to lose track of one or two of them. And that's also something that you have to keep in mind when you, in step four, you work with the professionals, the advertising agencies or whatever, the copywriters, who will actually create the intervention. So you have to keep track of the parameters for use and the change objectives to make sure that everything that actually allows your program to work is still in it when you're done. This is a website where we combine some free resources about behavior change. So if you want them, they're there. For example, about how to use the cyber plots I showed earlier. There's also an article there with all the methods of behavior change. So if you want to send the list of methods of behavior change to somebody else, then there's a free open access PDF there. So this might be useful if you have colleagues you work with. I will make sure it's sent around by Rob to everybody as well. So are there any questions? Can anybody still speak at this point? Or otherwise, what time is it?
Can you give some examples of themes that try to tie
a project together? So for example, my roomie at the Maastricht University here, when I was doing my PhD, his theme was queer masters. So they had an intervention to promote HIV testing among MSM, men who have sex with men. And there, it was like a quiz show. So it was queer masters and you could win, and which was actually a very useful format because you can actually, you have this game element in it already. So you can easily test knowledge, for example, in a way that's not too obvious. So that was very nice. My ecstasy intervention had dance venture. It was like an adventure in the dance scene, which also creates a game element that allows you to do lots of things. There's, what's the English word? Long live love? Is the English word for a very successful Dutch intervention on sexual health in high schools. There was the gay cruise, which was also nice, one of the first flash interventions, which was really fancy back then and now looks different. And yeah. Oh, of course, the double meaning. I'm not sure whether I ever.
Yeah.
I've been telling all these people about it, and I never. And there's the I don't know, the Spanish one in the that's also always in the book, the one from Maria. Just salute. So. Oh yeah, cultivating your health, which connects to basically the. Agricultural workers in Mexico and their health. And obviously, that's a very useful theme for them because they will all already feel connected to the topic. So those are some examples. I think actually come to think of it that when you go to an advertising agency, the theme might be mostly what they think of. So the way it looks, the superficial branding thing, that's also what they're very good at. It's just putting anything in it that works, that they're not so good. Any other questions? Or
maybe one interesting stuff. The queer masters, for instance, work very nice here. And the article was confused to have states because of the fact. So it means that in a different setting, it didn't work at all.
Yeah. So the theme, but that's. That makes sense for most of the things in your intervention because you target it, if you do it properly, to your culture, to your population. So that's why if you have an intervention from another country or another culture, you should first intervention mapping the living hell out of it to analyze it. And then you can figure out which components might work in your population and your setting and then reuse those. So basically in intervention mapping, kind of the idea is steal as much as you can, but make sure it will work if you steal it. Okay, well, thank you for your attention.